Highbridge, a division of Recorded Books, presents What Is It Like to Be a Bat? By Thomas Nagel. Read by Joe Barrett. Preface. What Is It Like to Be a Bat? Was published 50 years ago in the Philosophical Review, October 1974. In it, I tried to show that the irreducible subjectivity of consciousness is an obstacle to many proposed solutions to the mind-body problem. Since then, consciousness has gradually become a central topic of discussion in philosophy, psychology, and neuroscience, and the special problems posed by its distinctive character have received lots of attention. There is no agreement about how to deal with those problems. Some people believe consciousness can be accommodated in a materialist worldview. Others, myself included, believe the reality of consciousness implies that the physical sciences give an incomplete description of the natural order. Still others believe that our ordinary conception of consciousness may have to be abandoned or revised if it is incompatible with materialism. Perhaps because it presented the problem through a particularly vivid example, the essay has become a standard reference in many of these debates and in the theories that they have generated. In the early 1970s, I had a house in the country in Pennsylvania, and bats nested in the woodwork. At dusk, they would emerge to hunt for their dinner, but occasionally one of them would lose its way and end up inside the house instead, giving me an alarming experience of intimate contact with an alien creature. I suppose the bat felt the same. Thinking about the bat became part of my ongoing reflections on the mind-body problem and helped to provide a new way to pose it. By pointing out something we didn't and couldn't know about the bat's experience, namely what it was like for the bat, even though we could be confident that the thing we didn't know was real, I hoped to get people to recognize that there was more to the mind of the bat than could be captured by a physiological or behavioral description of the kind that is, in principle, accessible to us through observation. And by explaining why this feature of the bat's experience was inaccessible to us, I hope to pin down its crucial, essentially subjective character. The essay was conceived as a contribution to discussion of the mind-body problem, and the point about the bat was just a subsidiary step in the argument to the main conclusion, namely that the subjectivity of consciousness presents an obstacle to the reduction of the mental to the physical. But the bat took on a life of its own and became a standard reference in another area of discussion that came gradually to prominence over the same period, the topic of animal consciousness. As it happens, I may have contributed in another way to making that topic scientifically respectable. In 1973 to 1974, I was a visitor at Rockefeller University, one of whose luminaries was Donald Griffin, the zoologist who had discovered echolocation in bats. He kindly agreed to meet with me, and we had extensive conversations not only about bats, but about animal consciousness in general, and the reluctance of biologists and psychologists to talk about or even recognize it. He became persuaded that this was an important and neglected subject, and the result was his book, The Question of Animal Awareness, which had a significant influence in getting people to take the subject seriously. The field has now progressed to the point that there is extensive research on the consciousness and cognition not only of mammals and birds, but also of fish, mollusks, and insects. My essay is sometimes misinterpreted as claiming that because the subjective character of consciousness is beyond the reach of the objective physical sciences, it is beyond the reach of scientific understanding altogether. On the contrary, I believe what it shows is that scientific understanding should not be limited to the kind of theory of an objective external reality based on shared observation that characterizes the physical sciences. The reality of consciousness requires an expansion of our scientific ideas to accommodate what does not conform to the physical conception of objectivity. I touch on this point at the end of the essay with a suggestion of an objective phenomenology, but in the years following its publication, I continued to think about the mind-body problem, trying to imagine what a positive solution might look like if one took the subjectivity of consciousness seriously. For those who may be interested, I have included one such account as the second essay in this book. It was presented as a lecture at the annual meeting of the Association for the Scientific Study of Consciousness in 2023. The idea is more fully set out in a much longer essay called The Psychophysical Nexus, which can be found in my book Concealment and Exposure and Other Essays, Oxford University Press, 2002. Though necessarily tentative and very speculative, it expresses a position that I still think promising. The long life and continued salience of the Bat Paper has prompted its republication in this short book. The problem it poses is still very much with us. 1. What is it like to be a bat? Consciousness is what makes the mind-body problem really intractable. Perhaps that is why current discussions of the problem give it little attention or get it obviously wrong. The recent wave of reductionist euphoria has produced several analyses of mental phenomena and mental concepts designed to explain the possibility of some variety of materialism, psychophysical identification, or reduction.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.